Good day, this is Jim Pytel from Columbia Gorge Community College. This is Digital Electronics. This lecture is entitled Analysis of Synchronous Counters Using D Flip-Flops. In comparison to our last lectures where we did analysis of synchronous counters using JK flip-flops, this lecture is going to come as exceptional breeze because the D flip-flop is substantially easier to use than the JK flip-flop to create a synchronous counter because it just has one input. And very similar to the JK flip-flops, what we're going to try to do is just do a timing analysis of it and then realize, okay, the timing analysis has some limitations. Then we're going to go ahead and develop kind of a tabular format to go ahead and do this. And let's just say someone throws something on your desk. Here is a D flip-flop hooked up in a synchronous counter arrangement. How do I know it's synchronous counter? Well, all stages are getting the same clock pulse, and it has some logic that is on the D inputs. And we're going to go ahead and see how this thing behaves. What we want to do ultimately is develop a state machine diagram for this particular synchronous counter. The timing diagram analysis. Let's go ahead and assume stage Q0 and Q1 are both at zero, and they're going to stay at zero up until that positive edge. Okay, that positive edge occurs and the D inputs sample the input at that time. Now look at the input for D0. In this particular configuration, it is not Q1. If Q1 is zero, at the moment of that positive edge, not Q1 is a one. The stage Q0, its input D0 is sampling not Q1, and Q0 will reflect that. However, there is a momentary delay when that occurs. Again, it's a propagation delay that is constant for all devices. It's momentary, but it's essential to the operation of these things. Okay, let's go ahead and figure out what is the stage Q1's input, D1, have at the moment of that positive edge. Well, its input is Q0. Okay, at the moment of the positive edge, Q0 was a zero. What does Q1 do? It goes ahead and stays a zero until the next positive edge. And Q1, again, is the inversion of that. Okay, now we go ahead, the next positive edge occurs. What are we doing? Well, Q0's input, D0, is sampling not Q1. The moment of the positive edge, it is a 1, so it's going to stay a 1. What is the input for Q1, D1 seeing? Well, it's seeing Q0. At the moment of the positive edge, it's a 1. Okay, so what happens to Q1? Well, there's a measurable propagation delay at the moment of the positive edge. Let's go ahead and change to 1. What does not Q1 do after a little propagation delay? It reflects not Q1. Next positive edge occurs. What is Q0's input? D0? Well, it's not Q1. At the moment of the positive edge, it's sampling a 0. In a perfect world, we do that transition right there. It doesn't happen because there is a measurable propagation delay, and we go down to 0. What is Q1's input, D1, seeing? Well, it's seeing Q0 at the moment of the positive edge. Okay, it was a 1. Q1's going to stay a 1 until the next positive edge, and obviously not Q1 is going to be that inversion. Next positive edge occurs. What is Q0's input, D0, seeing? Well, it's seeing not Q1. It's sampling a 0, so Q0 will stay a 0. What is Q1's input, D1, seeing? It's seeing a 0, and Q1, after measurable propagation delay, will go down to 0, and not Q1 will go up to 1. And if we go ahead and continue this sequence with a couple more clock pulses, you'll see it does the same pattern over again for Q1, Q0. What have we created here? Okay, just look at the values for Q1, MSB, down to Q0, LSB. So it's 0, 0, 0, 1, 1, 1, 1, 0. And what are we doing? We're creating 0, 0. What we have in fact created is a 2-bit gray code up counter. So we're going from 0, 0, 0, 1, 1, 1, 1, 0, back to 0, 0. And if we wanted to, we could go ahead and do the state machine diagram from there. We were at 0, 0, went to 0, 1, went up to 1, 1, went to 1, 0, went to 0, 0, and we continue that loop over and over again. This is a method to go ahead and do. You could do this as the timing diagrams get bigger and bigger. It's going to get more and more complicated. There's a faster and easier and more systematic tabular method, which I'm going to show right here. Very similar to the analysis of synchronous counters using JK flip-flops tabular method. But what's awesome about this, we've only got one input to worry about. Pay attention to this, because this technique here, this analysis of synchronous counters using D flip-flops, is exceptionally useful when we go into registers a little bit later, because most of the examples I use for registers are created out of D flip-flops. Very similar to the JK flip-flops analysis of synchronous counters, we've got present inputs. First off, is this a Moore machine or a Mealy machine? Okay, a Moore machine, its next state is dependent only on its present state, whereas a Mealy machine, its next state is dependent not only on its present state, but some external input. So the answer is it's a Moore machine. It's just a counter. It counts in gray code regardless. Every positive clock edge that this thing sees, it's going to count. I know we did the timing analysis, and I know we came up with a finite state machine diagram. What we're going to try to do is use a tabular method to see if this, in fact, is true. And what we're going to do is not get lost in one of those chicken are the egg games, which you could potentially do inside a time and diagram analysis. So what you do is exhaust all possible combinations of input. Again, notice I've done this first. If there are only two inputs, I go from 00 to 11 using all my binary combinations. If there's three, I'd go from 000 down to 11 using all possible combinations. There is no relation from present to next. Basically, I do the present state first. Now, what I do, step two, is evaluate the inputs. What are the inputs for each stage? It's just one input each stage. What's D1? Well, D1, according to our diagram, it's right here. It's Q0. So just take Q0, put it there. 0, 1, 0, 1. Evaluate the input D0. What's D0? Well, to me, it looks like Q1's coming back here. It's getting inverted. There it is. So it's not Q1. So I'm evaluating the expression for not Q1. It would be 1, 1, 0, 0. Again, what I'm doing is I'm comparing, basing it off Q1 right there. That's my present input. If it's not Q1, it's going to look like this. So now, when a positive edge occurs, if this is the input at the positive edge, what does the next state do? Well, D1, D0 is Q1, Q0. So all you have to do is just take the evaluated expressions for D1, D0. Its next state is 01. Next state, 110010. I know we had a state machine diagram earlier developed from a timing diagram. Let's go ahead and see if our tabular method comes up with the same values. We are in 00. Go to 01. There you go. We are in 01. Go to 11. There you go. We are in 10. We go to 00. There you go. We are in 11. We go to 10. There you go. Exact same state machine diagram. This method is substantially easier for larger and more complicated circuits. And let's go ahead and give you an example of a larger, more complicated circuit. And when we develop the finite state machine diagram, you should recognize this thing. It's one of the previous examples we used in analysis of synchronous counters using JK flip-flops. Just going to show you, you could potentially design the same counter that does the same finite state machine diagram just using different technology. Here is a finite state machine, and it has some external input called X, and we're going to go ahead and see how this thing works. It's made out of D flip-flops. It's a synchronous counter, and we're going to use those exact same techniques. What we're going to do is list all possible combinations of input. Do that first. What are our inputs? Well, it's X and its present state Q1, Q0. And now what we're going to try to do is we're just going to go ahead and evaluate the expressions for D1, which by the way is right there, and D0, which is by the way right there. You can already see that it would almost be impossible to do this in a timing diagram. Look at the expression for D1. There's four product terms that are being ORed together, and D0 has three product terms that are being ORed together. It would be almost impossible to do this in a timing diagram. And what you're going to do is just go ahead and evaluate the expressions for D1 and D0 given that present state of inputs. This is super complicated, so we're going to take this in a step-by-step. What I've done is given you some intermediary columns there, and what we're going to do is just evaluate those intermediary product terms for D1, the intermediary product terms for D0, and you should look something like this. So those are the individual product terms based upon that present input there. What does D1 do when you OR all those together? What does D0 do when you OR all its product terms together? It should do something like this. So D1, D0. Now, what do you do with those? The next positive edge, Q1 and Q0, take the value of D1 goes to Q1. D0 goes to Q0. Basically, just translate those columns right into the next Q1, Q0 state. And that's what the Q1, Q0 next state should be. Okay, so can you develop finite state machine diagram for this? Given present state 00, X, the external input, is 0, it goes to state 11. So we have a 00, X is 0, we go to state 11. Now we are in state 01. X, the external input, is 0. Where do we go? We also go to 11. So I can put 0, 1 over here. If x is 0, we go to 1, 1. Now we are in present state 1, 0. The mode is 0. Where do we go to? State 0, 1. So we were in 1, 0. X, our external input, is 0. We're making the decision to go to 0, 1. Our present state is 1, 1. Our mode is 0. Where do we go to? 1, 0. So is this looking familiar? This is something that you may have seen in the JK flip-flops analysis of synchronous counters. But now what we've done is we've switched our mode. Our mode is 1. We are in 0, 0. When X is 1, we were in 0, 0. Where do we go to? We go to 0, 1. Now we are in state 0, 1. Our X is 1. Where do we go to? 1, 0. So we make this transition when X is 1. We go there. Finally, we're in 1, 0. Our mode is 1. Where do we go to? 1, 1. When X is 1, go to 1, 1. And our last condition, we are in state 1, 1. Our mode is 1. Where do we go to? 0, 1. So when X equals 1, what we're doing is we're transitioning from 1, 1 to 1, 0. Okay, I'll redraw the diagram. It's looking exactly like what we did for the analysis of synchronous counters using JK flip-flops. I'm just going to use some color now. And so there is our colorized diagram. And what it's showing is when we are in mode 0, we are in 0, 0, go to 1, 1, go to 1, 0, go to 0, 1, go to 1, 1, and keep on running that counterclockwise loop as long as we're in mode 0. However, if we were in 0, 0 and mode was 1, go this way, we're in the clockwise loop now. Notice that there are different expressions, obviously, because there's only one input per stage, but it's still doing the same finite state machine behavior. Just going to show you, you could potentially use two different devices to develop the same finite state machine behavior. Substantially easier because, again, D1 is Q1's next state. D0 is Q0's next state. Substantially easier than using analysis of JK flip-flops. Let's conclude this lecture and move on to the next one.